plastic waste drifting in the water. Filming that revealed the damage being done by our throwaway culture.
There's a worldwide plastic production of 350 million tons per year, and about 300 million tons are ending up as a waste.
It's hard to believe, but this is actually a river.
We've put billions of tons, actually, of plastic into the environment. By 2050, people have predicted that there'll be more plastic in the ocean than fish in terms of weight.
Remnants of our products have spread to every corner of the planet. Plastics are in the food we eat and the water we drink. With both global production of plastics and the cost of recycling rising, the outlook is bleak. But our planet has a remarkable way of fighting back. Recently discovered plastic-eating bacteria has given scientists hope. Hope to decontaminate our planet and make cleaner products for the future.
Plastics take the stage at an international exhibit in Amsterdam. The ingenious alchemy of coal and oil provides the material. Ingenious machinery presses and stamps and molds the material into a wide variety of products, articles for household use, as well as tools for industry.
Strong, light, cheap, easy to clean. Quite simply, plastic is a miracle material.
In the world of tomorrow, plastics will certainly call the tune.
The beginning of the 20th century saw a revolution in production, and it's changed our lives for the better in immeasurable ways.
Everything has to be of plastic. Even furniture was created of plastic until the 1970s.
It saves lives. It stops us getting sick. It gets us from A to B. Not a day goes by without near total dependence on it. From our clothes, our shoes, to our phones. And as the slogan for the first fully synthetic plastic claimed, it really is a material of 1,000 uses. Before becoming totally ubiquitous, such products seemingly lasted forever. But that advantage from 50 years ago is now a dangerous flaw. The plastic coffee cup we use for a couple of minutes will stay in our environment for hundreds, if not thousands of years without decomposing. It's estimated more than 8 billion tons of plastic has been produced since the 1950s. In 2016, a team of Japanese scientists made a discovery that had the potential to turn the tide in the fight against plastic.
They were scraping around in the soil and wastewater runoff of a recycling facility in Japan. They actually found a bacteria that remarkably was living off the plastic bottles themselves. So they took that back to the lab and they were able to culture it, just feeding it a diet of plastic, PET plastic. That's the plastic for bottles and clothing and carpets and that sort of thing. So it's a very common plastic in the environment. They've evolved to eat various types of food sources. And what seems to be happening in that rubbish dump in Japan is that they're secreting a couple of enzymes, and those enzymes actually break apart the polymer chain in the plastic, providing molecules as food.
Professor John McGeehan and his team at Portsmouth University in the UK are one of several groups around the world now investigating the potential of plastic-eating bacteria.
So to understand the process of how this works, we kind of need to understand what a polymer is. So PET plastic is an incredibly common plastic in the environment, and it's made of two building blocks, one called ethylene glycol and the other called terephthalic acid. And basically these building blocks are kind of held together by bonds called ester bonds. So then you get poly, lots of ester, polyester, and this is our plastic. So if you look on your clothing, you'll probably see a label saying polyester. That's all it is those building blocks linked together in long chains to create these plastics. And all an enzyme needs to do is come along and snip those bonds like a big pair of molecular scissors, and then you get the building blocks back again.
So you found a bacteria that's living in a rubbish dump. How do you then get enzymes out of it?
Actually, these days it's very simple. You grow the bacteria in the lab and then coding within that bacteria is DNA. It's like a four-letter code that codes for the, it's like the instruction manual for that enzyme. We can pull that out and make it synthetically in the lab. These are the two individual enzymes that are produced by that bacteria in the rubbish dump in, found in Japan. And what we did in the laboratory is take those two separate enzymes. The first one is called PETase and the second one's called MHETase. And we physically linked them together to make this chimeric enzyme. And we found that this one was around six times faster than the original natural enzyme that we originally studied. So what we can show here is that we can take some learnings from nature, take them back to the lab, and then adapt things to make them faster and more efficient, which is what we need if we're going to have a economically viable recycling solution. Enzymes are really ubiquitous in nature, and they're used for making things and breaking things. So the human body is full of enzymes. We use enzymes every day in our biological washing powders. They contain those powdered enzymes that can break down grass stains and our food stains. So we're actually, as a technology, it's very mature. So then turning enzymes towards problem materials like plastics really seems like a sensible way forward. The sorts of enzymes we're using today in the food industry and the pharmaceutical industry, they were also very slow when they were first discovered. And over years of generations, we've managed to improve them to be, in some cases, 100 or even 1,000 times faster than the original natural variants. So this gives us hope.
The dream is to produce industrial quantities of enzyme, which can be freeze-dried and turned into a powder. This would then be poured over to break down the waste products. What you're left with is a clear solution of monomers.
These are the building blocks that you would originally get from oil and gas, and they're exactly the same, except this time you can do it over and over again in infinite circular economy style. And this is where we want to get to. Currently, the enzymes are too slow to be economically viable.
You're dealing with PET plastic, but there's plenty of other types, aren't there? So does that complicate recycling?
PET is around maybe 20% of the plastic out there, but we also have lots of other types of plastic, polyethylene, plastic bags, polypropylene for harder plastics, PVC, many, many different types. And of course, this is the problem. If you're a recycling facility, you need a way to sort through these and pull out value from these materials. And that's a real challenge. And this is what we're struggling with. We tend to demonize plastics, but actually it's not how we use them, it's how we dispose of them that's the real issue.
We've never been that good at recycling. Even before the pandemic, when major corporations like Danone and Coca-Cola were pledging to increase recycled plastics in their packaging, only about 9% of all plastic ever produced has been made into something new.
It's rather disconcerting that less than 10% of plastic bottles are actually recycled back into plastic bottles. Part of the reason for that is economics.
The falling price of oil has compounded the problem. It's meant it's become much cheaper to make brand new plastic, so manufacturers have less incentive to use recycled materials.
Companies really want to use recycled material, but it's expensive and it's often of poor quality. That's because if you mechanically recycle PET or other plastics, if you've got any contaminants, colours and things, basically the material loses its material properties each time you do it. So even though people, when they put those bottles in the green bin, think it's going to turn back into a bottle, often it's downcycled and it's on a sad path to landfill.
In Leipzig, Germany, another team of scientists are working with plastic-eating enzymes. They're targeting polyurethane, a plastic of complex chemistry.
So there are four, five, six different monomers. In polyurethane, we have the keyword urethane bonds, which are very, very complex and very stable. Yeah. Therefore, we use that things for our shoe soles. Yeah, we don't want that after 10 kilometers of running, the shoes are broken.
Sneakers are products that are often made up of multiple types of plastics. When products are made like this, it can make it much harder and less economical to recycle. While their work in breaking down polyurethane, or PU, is an important step, Dr. Highpiper actually sees the best application in making plastic. Not any old plastic, though. Material that breaks down once used. That means changing how we make things, like creating sneakers that use just one species of plastic, which are less chemically stable and therefore better at biodegrading.
So the dream of this magic bacteria that eats all of the plastic, that's not close to reality, you don't think?
No, not really, no. Normally these bacteria don't survive in the dump site. Yeah, so the lab rats don't survive in the real environment. And that means that cannot be the idea behind our research. The question for us microbiologists is not to solve the problem of waste by biological solution, what we call bioremediation. This cannot be the answer. Yeah, but the answer must be that we get a kind of picture what kind of plastic and plastic waste, respectively, is degradable in order to give the politicians, and there we go to big science, to give the politicians a kind of advice what to stop and what not to stop.
If you can develop a process where you can break that plastic down again, there's plenty of it, there's no feedstock problem, and you have a low energy and low carbon route to doing that, you can start generating those monomers, those building blocks competitively. I can see there being a massive economic switch. It doesn't need to be on a level par, it just needs to be close. And then suddenly you have an opportunity there where businesses can jump in and make an awful lot of money, I would say, using those technologies to feed a growing market. Let's not kid ourselves, plastic is going to keep growing. And if we can have recycled feedstocks in the mix, that's one way to bring down the CO2 and the carbon budget.
The problem of plastic waste is now very much in the mainstream, and the cause has support all over the world. But our planet is at a critical moment as its use continues to grow. Innovations like enzymes from plastic-eating bacteria could help reimagine the entire system.